both Marilyn and Eleanor shared reflections and told stories. So I thought I'd begin my reflections with a story as well, but my story is not nearly as good as theirs is. I've never told it in church before, and I probably never will after today. When I was a student minister, just 24 years old, my supervising minister assigned me the task of doing regular volunteer work with a local charity. And so I spent every Thursday morning volunteering at a local food pantry. When I arrived, my first day, I noticed that there were two groups of volunteers sorting donated food into the correct categories, separating the canned corn from the canned peas from the canned beans. One group of volunteers were in their late 60s, early 70s. They were retired folks giving back to their community. And the other group of people were young folks in their early 20s, and my peers, because I was just 24 at the time, and that's who I gravitated towards. And so I approached the table, and all of us were around in a circle sorting cans, and as we sorted cans, we were chatting. And all of a sudden, one of the people in the circle says, "So how many hours did people get?" And then he answered his own question, I stole a car, and I have to do 50 hours. And the next person around the circle says, I got 25 hours for drug possession. And next is the woman to my left, and she said, I got 25 hours of community service for shoplifting. And then it came to me. Oh, I said, I'm gonna be doing this for the rest of my life. What'd you do? They asked. Come on, you can tell us. We all said what we did. I'm preparing to become a minister, I said. I'm going to be doing this for the rest of my life. And they act very unimpressed about that. The members of our community service ministry, wow. They're the ones who are the lifers. They are the ones, and that's as often without any glory or without any, you know, considerable praise and attention. They're the ones who for years and years have been going every week to the shelter to meet the clients there, every week after week to the food service to serve meals. They've been the ones who show up Saturday after Saturday after Saturday for Habitat. They're there, cooking and serving meals, assembling backpacks, holding food drives, building houses. And so what I'd like to do is I'd like to make three different observations about community service ministry from a spiritual perspective and talk about their work and a little bit. The first thing that I want to say about community service ministry is that for some people, especially when I go out and do volunteering, it's in a very different place than how I spend my life. I think that part of modern society, especially for those of us who live and work in an information economy and spend our working lives in meetings and in front of screens, and talking with people, and those jobs are so prevalent here in the Triangle, that part of modern society can wind up being felt as this experience of a radical disconnect between our efforts and our impact. I like to imagine that if you dig ditches for a living, you can stop at the end of every single day and survey your work, and you can see exactly how many feet and how many inches of ditch you've dug. And I think about my own life. My own life, on a typical day, I can go to two committee meetings, respond to 3 dozen emails, contemplate the theology of forgiveness, make a hospital visit, and write a memo for the board. And I can look back at the end of the day and realize that I spent the whole day working hard and engaged and focused, but be completely unsure if I accomplished anything. And the great thing about community service ministry is that when you actually serve, you see that impact. You see those accomplishments immediately. You can look back at the end of your day and count exactly how many nails you put into that house at the Habitat worksite. You can count how many plates of food you served. You can see the 160 backpacks that you stuffed lined up and know the impact of 160 children having school supplies. Another reflection that I have is that it's been said in the modern era, but it's not true, that the life of the spirit, like spirituality, is somehow separate from the life of labor and service. And that's a modern myth. It's just not true. If you go back in history and look at the earliest Christian monastic communities, the communities in Alexandria, Egypt, and elsewhere, you actually find that those Christian monasteries where monks went to live, they were all working communities. Those Christian monks in the 2nd and 3rd and 4th centuries operated soup kitchens that fed thousands and thousands of people daily. They didn't just pray all day. They prayed all day, but they didn't just pray all day. They prayed all day and served all day. Go to Green Gulch Zen Center in the Bay Area and talk with the people who are living there. Every single person there living in monastic community also works the farm. It's a strange thing for us to separate spirituality and service. Gandhi required his followers to learn how to use a spinning wheel. It's also a strange thing to want to focus to try to separate service from justice work. There's an old story that's been told that's meant to illustrate the difference between service work and justice work, and the story goes like this. Imagine a village on the banks of a river. The people of that village are kind and generous and hardworking and welcoming, and life is good in that village. Except that there's one peculiar feature of living there. You see, every so often, the villagers will look out and see a child floating down the river. And when that happens, they send their service committee, their community service ministry, out to pull the child out from the river, to feed and clothe the child and give the child a place to sleep and an education. As time passes on, the villagers begin to spot more and more children floating down the river, and soon they organize an around-the-clock volunteer force, rescuing children and caring for them. And then, after some time, when they're feeling tired, some of the villagers have an idea. Let's send a team up the river to find who's putting children in the river and tell them to stop. There are disagreements. Some in the village say that the children are coming at such an accelerated rate that we can't possibly spare anyone. And others say if we don't investigate and change what's happening upstream, we'll soon be completely overwhelmed. Finally, under protest, a group of the villagers break away and head upstream, and that's how the first social justice committee was established. The problem with this story is that it's always seemed to me to be impossibly dualistic, separating people into one group or another group, when in reality there's actually all this overlap. It's not either one thing or the other. And I think some people do fall entirely in one camp or entirely in the other, but for a lot of us, we're divided between a couple of different camps. And for some, it's actually being in one that inspires us to move to the other, or that it's being in the other inspires us to move back to the one. I think of a lot of people who've had that experience, like Marilyn shared, that experience of kind of wading into that river. And then when they come out, they realize they need to head upstream. And there's a lot of people who head upstream and realize a passion for actually coming back and wading out into the river, getting deep in there and connecting. That it's the relationships that one makes doing one that inspires us to do the other. And so I encourage us to reject that really stark dichotomy and dualism between the two. Finally, I want to invite you today in the Jones Building, I want to invite you to after the service, go to the tables. They'll have all the different tables. Eleanor will have a table with about the backpack program. There will be a table for Habitat. There will be a table, Maureen and Shannon will be there with their brightly sparkly hats, with a table for the Interfaith Council and all the other organizations, El Centro and the others that the Community Service Ministry supports. And they'll be actually talking with you about how you might get involved if you choose to do that. And so I encourage you to go and visit them after the service today. Let's sing. Our closing hymn this morning is one, and I have to tell you that the Community Service Ministry, they picked all the hymns for this morning, and this closing hymn, hymn 121, fits perfectly with what they do. It's, we'll build a land where we bind up the broken, we'll build a land where the captives go free, where the oil of gladness dissolves all mourning. We'll build a promised land that can be number 121 in the great hymnal. And after the hymn ends, please continue standing for the benediction. Let's sing.